Hey everyone, welcome to part 10 of this 12-part Python tutorial series for beginners. In this chapter, we're going to learn about user input in Python and how you can make your Python scripts interactive. Ultimately, the reason we write Python code is that so we can do useful things for people. But that means we're going to need a way to get input data from the world somehow. And that could be through a direct input, like somebody typing something into a console, or it could be from a local file, like an Excel file or a PDF file. Or it could even be over the internet. So you could have a Python app that communicates with other apps all over the internet. In this chapter, we're going to go over each of these types of inputs and see how you can implement them in Python. The easiest way to get user input from Python is just to have our users type it in directly into our terminal. So when you run your Python app and the terminal prompt shows up, that's where we want them to type a piece of input. In our upcoming final project at the end of this tutorial series, we're going to be building a personal expense tracking app. In that app, we're going to want our users to be able to enter the name and the amount of each expense that they want to track. To do this, we can use the inbuilt input function that Python provides us. When you use this input function inside your Python script, the terminal will stop executing at that line, and then it will prompt the user to enter something into the terminal. And we can even make this show a text prompt by putting a string as an argument into this input function. In this example, if we use this and then the terminal stops here at this line, the users are going to be prompted with a line that says enter your name, and then it'll just wait until the user types something in and then press enter. And whatever the user types into this prompt will be available to us because this function will ultimately return that as its value. To store the value that the user types in, we can use the assignment operator to set that value into a variable like this. So here, if we use the input function, we can assign whatever that resolves to into a variable called username. And now we can use username as like any other string variable. That's because this input statement is actually a built-in Python function. And whenever the user types in something and press enter, that value that they typed in will be returned as a string. Now let's hop over to the terminal and give that a try for ourselves. First, I'm going to start by creating a variable to store my input result. And I'm going to call this username, just like in the example. And then we'll type equals and input. So here is the built-in input function. We don't need to enter something in here yet. And I'll show you what that does in a sec. To see the result of this, we can print the username. And I'll say something like you entered, and then I'll put that variable here. Now let's go ahead and run that. And when you run it, we'll see that it stopped here waiting for us to enter something in the prompt. So let's go ahead and enter a name. And then when you hit enter, you'll see that it says you've entered Jack because this is the print statement. But if we want this to make it say something when it prompts us to enter the input, we can put that in here instead as the prompt. So say enter a name and put a colon. And don't forget to put a space because it's just going to print out this entire string. So if you want a space, then put that. And then I'll save it and refresh my window and run that again. Now it prompts us to enter a name. So I can, and then when I press enter, it'll show up here. So this is how we can use the input function to capture user data and have them enter anything they want. And this is a very common mistake that beginner developers at Python tend to make, is that they don't understand that this value is always a string. So even if I change this into a number, like enter a number here, and then I'll turn this into X instead, and then I'll also this into X. If I run this, it'll say enter a number, and I can enter a number like 32. And then it looks all nice and fine here because it's just printing it out. But if I try to multiply it, for example, if I don't want to print this line, but I want to print X times 100 instead, if I run that and I enter 32 again, you'll see that it doesn't give me the result I expect. So if you ever need this input to be a number, for example, you want to build a calculator or something that takes numerical inputs, you need to turn this variable into a number as well. And in Python, we could do it easily by basically wrapping this whole variable inside an int function. So in Python, we can write int and then just wrap that with parentheses, and that will turn it into an int. And you can also convert floats into an int this way. So let's run that again and see if it fixes our problem. So it says enter a number, and I'm going to put in 32. And now it gives us the correct answer for 32 times 100. which is 3,200. This input result is always a string, and if you need it to be a number, you can wrap it inside this int function. This technique is called casting, so it's when you turn a type of data into a different type. So here we're turning a string 32 into the number 32 by casting it into an int. And I can cast it into a float as well. So if I run this again, my result is now a float. Now, there's a couple of other ways we can get user input in Python. It is slightly out of scope of this tutorial series, so we won't go too deep into them, but we're just going to take a quick look. The first thing we're going to look at are CLI arguments. It's possible to pass in arguments to the Python program when you run it from the command line. These are called command line arguments. Looking at this code example here, I want to run my program, main.py, and I want to pass this number, 128, into the program so that it can do something with that number. So how do I read this from within my Python script? Now, any information we pass in at the command line is actually available to us from our script through this system arg v. So let's see how we can use that. To use it, we'll first have to import the Python system library. So that's import and then sys for system. And then we can access all of those arguments in the sys.argv variable. So if we just print this out, you're going to see that all of our values are stored there. So now I'm not going to do anything else. I'm just going to go ahead and run the program, Python main py, and then just the random number that I'm passing in. And then if I hit enter and run that, you'll see that the value of this argv is this list here. And the first element of the list is always going to be the name of the program. So that's going to be main.py, which is the file name. But the second element of the list is actually this value that I've entered here as my command line argument. So if I wanted just that value, just that number, I can actually store that inside a variable. So I could do something like this. And because argv is just a normal list, when I do argv1, it's accessing that second element, which is going to be my value. So now I can print x to get that value. And then if I run that in my terminal again using this command, you'll see that now I can access this 128 value that I pass in as my command line argument. As usual, this is also going to be a string, so if I wanted to use this as a number, I would have to cast it as well. Just showing you this, if I run this again, it treats it exactly like a string. And if I wanted to use it as a number, I can also just cast it with an int. Now I can use this as a number. So if you wanted to run a Python program that accepts arguments directly from the command line like this, you can use sysargv to read each of those commands. But actually, if you were more serious about writing an actual Python command line program, I recommend you looking up this argparse library, which is also an inbuilt library in Python. And instead of having to use argv, you can do more complex things like specify the types of arguments that are accepted and shorthands for each argument that you pass. And there's just a whole lot of functionality. So you can actually write a really complex program by using this library, if that's what you wanted to do. It's also possible to read input from a file as well, whether that's a PDF file, image file, CSV spreadsheet, or just a plain text file. And the code snippet to do that looks like this. So we'll type with open and then the name of our text file, for example, input.txt. And then we also need to specify how we want to open the file. So we can have R for read or W for write. But in this case, we want to read it. So we put R. And then we need a name to refer to this file that we've just opened. So I've called that f here. So basically what this line is saying is that I want to open this input text file in read mode, and I'm going to reference it through this variable f. And in the scope of that with statement, I use input data equals to f.read. So that's how I can read raw data from a text file as a string and put it into a variable. And the reason that we need to use this with keyword is because when you open a file in Python, it will stay open until you explicitly close it. And if you forget to close it and you open up a lot of files, it can cause a lot of problems for your systems. So using this with keyword creates something called a context manager, and it will automatically close the file for you when you are done using it. So when your code exits the scope of that with statement block, it will automatically close the file that you've opened. So let's hop over to our editor and try it out. So I've got my statement here with open, and then input.txt, R for read. Here's my F, which is going to be how I refer to the file, and I can read data from the file directly like this. So this is going to be a string, and at the end, I print this input string. In the same folder, I've got my input.txt, which I just typed in hello from text file, so it's just one line there. And so if we run this, we'll see that this hello from text file is now printed out to the terminal. So Python's able to read that file for us. And if we want to write to a file in Python, it's also really easy. Most of it looks the same, but I'm going to change the file name. So instead of having it write to input, I'm going to have it write to output.txt. And with the file mode, I need to change this to W because I want to write to the file. So instead of using fread, we will use fwrite instead. And here we can put anything we want. So I'm going to put a string and I'm going to call it hello from Python. And because when we write to a file, we actually need to tell it when to make new lines. So there's a special character that stands for new line, which is a backspace n. And when our file sees this, it's going to treat it as a new line. And usually it's a good idea to end all our lines with a new line. I don't know if the editor shows it very clearly, but the slash n is in a slightly different color from the rest of the string, because our IDE recognizes that it is a special character. And we don't have input data anymore, so I'm going to delete that last print statement. So this is what our code looks like. And if this file doesn't exist, Python will create it and write this in here. But if the file does exist, it will basically just overwrite it. So let's reset our terminal and run that again. And when I run it, I don't see any output in my terminal, but I see this output file appear in my file explorer. And if I open that output file, you can see the line that we've written from Python. Probably by far the most popular way to communicate with the world from Python, or from any program in general, is by having it talk with other apps over the internet. There's a lot of different ways for this communication to happen, but the most common way is with REST APIs. This is by sending a structured message to an HTTP endpoint, like a URL, and then getting responses back. And here's an example of an HTTP endpoint. So GitHub actually provides a public API that people can use to query it for information. So here's my GitHub user profile. It's Pixigami. And if I hit this endpoint, it's going to give me a whole bunch of information about my profile. And anybody can hit this. This is a public endpoint, so you don't even need to be me to hit this endpoint. So if you go to your editor and write your Python code exactly like this, you should be able to get the same information. So we have to import a library called requests, which you'll probably have to install first because it doesn't come default with Python. But don't worry about that if you don't have it just yet, because as I said, this is an advanced topic. So you don't need to replicate this code. I just want to show you how it works. Once you have the request library, we'll create an endpoint variable, which is just going to be a string. So if you write this code into your editor, it might not work if you don't have the request library installed. And I haven't covered how to install or uninstall third-party libraries into Python yet, so don't worry about copying this part of the code. I just want to run it for you in my editor to show you how it works. So I'll import requests here. I'll have my endpoint string here, and then I can do request get endpoint, and that will hit the endpoint and give me the data that is the response of that. As we've seen before, most of the internet communicates using JSON data. And if you don't remember that, then go check out the chapter on dictionaries to see what JSON does. And I get this data as a JSON format, and I can turn it into an object. So I can actually print that out. And now if I run my program, you'll see that I actually get a whole bunch of data because this GitHub API gives us quite a lot of information. But let's say that I only care about the name and the location of this user. I can instead print out data and then the name key and then data and the location key. And it should give me these values. So if I clear my terminal and then I run this again, you'll see that now I can get very specific data from this endpoint. So from this example, you could probably see how useful communication over the internet can be. And that is why most apps and most Python programs communicate with the world this way, through APIs and endpoints, and not through user input directly through the terminal or through a file. Now let's wrap up this chapter with a short coding exercise just to practice what we've learned. For this coding exercise, I want you to write a Python program that asks the user for their name and their age. And then I want you to save this information into a file called userinfo.txt. So pause this video and give this a go. I'm not giving you any starter code for this time. Here's just the comments to get you started, but it's a pretty easy program to write. So give that a go for yourself and then resume once you have your solution. And I'll show you what I did for this. And welcome back. And here is my solution for this problem. So our problem was to write a program that prompts a user for their name and age and then save that information into a file called userinfo.txt. So first, we're going to prompt the user for information, which is using this input command here. And then I'm going to set that equal to name and then set a second one equal to age. So I'm going to prompt them twice and store the results into these variables. And then I'm going to write this information to a file. So looking at what we've learned earlier, we can use this with open statement to open a file. And then my file is going to be called userinfo.txt. And I'm going to open it with this W method, which stands for write. And I'm going to use f.write and just put in the name and the age. So let's give this a go and run our application. So what is your name? And I'm just going to enter Jack. And what is your age? And I'm going to enter 24. I'm not really 24, but I'm going to enter it anyway. And then I hit enter and the program's done running. And if I open that userinfo.txt, I'll see my information is there. So this is how I would solve this programming exercise. So that's the end of this tutorial. I hope you now know how to work with user input and files in Python and understand how you can use them to make your app more interactive. See you in the next video where you're going to learn about classes in Python, which will give you a way to group together functions and code into a single object. And you can think of classes also as sort of like a blueprint for creating new copies of that object.